Is it true that the early church fathers rejected postmillennialism? The answer is no.
Even topics like eschatology. You'll be interested to know that every single church father who we know about was a premillennialist. Up until about 250 AD, 250 AD, 250 AD, Clement of Alexandria was the first amillennialist. He was also the father of the allegorical hermeneutic. Not surprising. I mentioned that because I said eschatology. That's really cool. When you're preaching through Revelation, you get to Revelation 21-6, and everyone in your congregation is saying, well, I know that's what the Bible says, but my Reformed friend tells me that church history never interpreted it that way. You can say, well, that's not true. For the first 300 years of church history, premillennialism was absolutely the predominant view of the church. It wasn't for a variety of reasons, including the allegorical hermeneutic, that suddenly amillennialism became the dominant view. So church history becomes very confirming, very affirming.
Yes, in a sense, but ultimately, no. Okay, so let me read real quick. Let me read a couple excerpts that I have highlighted here, okay? As far as our preserved writings go, I did all that because I first wanted you to see, you know, who cares about the church fathers if we're comparing that to the witness of Scripture? First, I wanted you to see that postmillennialism, I believe, is in the Bible. And there are multiple other places we could go. Isaiah chapter 65.
Isaiah 65 talks about the righteousness of God's judgment, how he's watching these people who are provoking him to anger. He's sacrificing the gardens to Baal and burn incense and things of that nature. Sit among the dead in the graves, you know, all these abominable things that are sin before him. And he talks about his servants and their righteousness. And then we get down to verse 17. For behold, I will create a new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. So as we're getting into the millennium here, the millennial reign, there is a brand new creation, and the old is burnt up and done away with, like in 2 Peter chapter 3, or 2 Thessalonians 1 and 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 John. Be glad and rejoice forever in what I create, for behold, I will create Jerusalem as a rejoicing. The new Jerusalem coming down in the latter end of Revelation, and her people a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying. So no more suffering, no more sorrow, no more death, no more sickness, like Revelation says. No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days, for the child shall die at 100 years old, and the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. This is very much like Isaiah chapter 11. This is the new heavens, new earth. My elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. So it's not just this temporal earth we're living in now. And our labor won't be in vain. So that whole vanity of Ecclesiastes will be done with. It'll be over. So this is the literal millennial reign. This is the literal new heavens, new earth. It shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. And here we go, verse 25. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. So there's no more death, there's no more suffering, there's no more sin, and the dust shall be the serpent's food. He shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, says the Lord. So there you go. The lion and the lamb together, the lion and the wolf together, rather, and the lion eating straw. So this is very much like Isaiah chapter 11. So Isaiah 65 is a great place to talk about the literal new heavens and new earth, and has nothing to do with post-millennialism.
1 Corinthians chapter 15.
Just a few corrections here. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is an incredible chapter about Jesus being the one who conquered death. And he rose on the third day, was seen by 500, and he's the first fruits of the resurrection, verse 20. And it says, afterwards, those of us who are in Christ will be raised from the dead at his appearing, at his coming, second coming, which hasn't taken place yet. So that's an anti-postmillennial verse, which verse 23 right there says that it's not postmillennial, that it's premillennial, that he's going to come before the millennium. Okay, at the end, he's going to deliver the kingdom, and he's going to defeat death at the very end. At the end of the millennial reign, he will defeat death. That's the last thing to be killed. He says that there in 26. This is repeated in Revelation chapter 20. It says, now when all things are made subject to him, then the Son of Man will also be subject to him who has put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So that's a future tense. That means this is happening before the millennium, which means the millennium is in the future. And then verses 50 through 58 is the famous passage about our glorification. And this is going to happen when Jesus appears a second time. And then that's also the same time, the glorification, the last trumpet there, which is mentioned in verse 52, the last trumpet. So that's the last trumpet of Revelation. That's the trumpet we see in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. This is the trumpet where the dead are raised. So this is the last trumpet occurs at the appearing of Christ. And then, according to Revelation 20, after that resurrection, then the millennium begins. So because the resurrection hasn't taken place yet, the millennium has not begun yet. So 1 Corinthians 15 is a proof of premillennial post-tribulation rapture.
There are many different other things that we could look at. Revelation chapter 1, and we'll look at that here in a moment.
Revelation chapter 1, we're looking at Jesus Christ giving his revelation to John. He gives him a greeting, talks about the seven spirits, about those of the seven churches. In verse 11, Jesus in his glory, 11 through 16. When you get down to verses 13 through 17, we see the man clothed with the garment down to his feet with the golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, white as snow. His eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass as refined in the furnace. His voice is the sound of many waters, or as Daniel says, the voice of a multitude. So that multitude in Daniel is the voice of many waters. In his right hand, the seven stars. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, which is the word of God. We know that from Hebrews 4. And so these seven stars are the seven angels to the seven churches, right? And he says that in verse 20. The seven stars are the seven angels to the seven churches. He's just basically announcing who he is. And that he's the first and the last, he's the Alpha and Omega. And that passage from 13 to 16 parallels. So Daniel 10, verse 5, starting at verse 5. I lifted my eyes, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with the gold of Uphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. So Daniel chapter 10, verses 5 through 6, is the same vision that John is seeing in Revelation 1, 13 through 16. And so he's given that introduction that he's going to speak to the seven churches. These seven churches that are discussed in chapters 2 and 3 are obviously the literal churches of that first century, but they also can symbolically and spiritually be pictures of the church and church ages, as some have alluded to, some theologians have alluded to, over the course of all of church history, from the time of Pentecost up and through the time of the tribulation to come. So we'll see those parallels as we enter the tribulation. Nothing here describing postmillennialism.
First, I wanted you to see it's biblical. Second, I want you to see that it does bear the witness of church history and the early church fathers as well.
Every single church father who we know about was a premillennialist up until about 250 AD.
Here we go. Some things that I want to highlight. As far as our preserved writings go, premillennialism finds a slightly earlier development, okay, than postmillennialism. So anybody who says that premillennialism is the earliest in terms of church history, is the earliest eschatology, they are correct. That's true. However, dispensational premillennialism is not the earliest. In fact, dispensational premillennialism is only about 150 years old. No one had even heard of that before Darby and the Scofield Bible and these kinds of things. So when people say premillennialism, you need to specify with them, clarify, and say, do you mean a historic premill view? Okay, yeah, there's validity there. I think it's wrong, but it's well underneath the banner of Christian orthodoxy. We can agree to disagree, and it does have early roots in the witness of church history, a historic premillennialism. Dispensational premillennialism, like money is the root of all kinds of evil. The love of money, I should say, is the root of all kinds of evil. And no, I'm not going to dignify dispensational premillennialism. I'm not. And that is not within church history. That is 150. It's a very novel idea. And I think that it is unhelpful and harmful. And most importantly, not rooted in the scripture. So the first eschatology that we see in church history is technically premillennialism, but it is historic premillennialism, not dispensational premillennialism. So premillennialism finds a slightly, and it's not much, but a slightly earlier development than postmillennialism, primarily in the writings of Irenaeus, Irenaeus. His lifespan was AD 130 to AD 202, AD 130 to AD 202. Okay, let me skip forward here a little bit. But postmillennialism was already anticipated, you could argue, in the early church father, Eusebius of Caesarea.
Let me help you out there. Eusebius.
Eusebius, who was the 4th century church historian, was very much an amillennialist. We'll take a little bit of time later in this class to discuss the development of amillennialism during these early centuries. But as an amillennialist, Eusebius did not have a lot of tolerance for earlier church fathers who were premillennialists, and so he referred to Papias as a man of small mental capacity because he believed in a literal millennial kingdom. So the eschatological trash-talking between premillennialists and amillennialists has a long history. And we know that he was a hearer of the Apostle John, a companion of Polycarp, and a man of old time, and that comes from Irenaeus. Irenaeus himself, a disciple of Polycarp.
Eusebius is very famous for nailing down the genealogies of Jesus in Matthew and Luke, that they are the same genealogy, except Heli and Jacob. Eusebius said that Heli and Jacob were both brothers by the same mother. Heli dying childless, Jacob raised up seed to him, having Joseph, according to nature belonging to himself, but by law to Heli. Thus Joseph was the son of both. By the Mosaic law, he would have been the son of Heli, carrying on the lineage. Though Heli died, his brother Jacob is actually his true natural biological father. So one is by nature, one genealogy is by nature, and one genealogy is by the law.
Okay, let me skip a little further now. Let's see. And then Origen is probably the earliest that we find the post-mill eschatology. This would be AD 185 to AD 254.
Clement of Alexandria had been a teacher in a training school there in Alexandria, and Origen took over that training school after Clement. So he trained others. His hermeneutic, he was not the father of the allegorical hermeneutic, but he was certainly the popularizer of it, and that allegorical hermeneutic came to define the school of Alexandria. It becomes one of the two principal schools of influence in Roman Christianity in the centuries that follow. And when we read in Olson, you'll soon find that the allegorical school of Alexandria came into massive conflict with the literal school of Antioch, and those two methods of interpretation come to define really the the Nicene and post-Nicene period of the church in the Roman Empire. It actually becomes a massive issue in church history that you guys will read about as you continue reading in Olson. I wanted to read just a little bit from Needham's book on Origen's allegorical hermeneutic. I know you read in Litvin about Origen's allegorical hermeneutic, but I think it's helpful to read maybe a little bit different perspective. John Calvin, for example, considered Origen's allegorical hermeneutic to be what he called the root, I think he called it the root of all kinds of evil, and talked about how Satan, with his deepest subtlety, had infiltrated the church with it. So from a Reformed perspective, Origen's allegorical hermeneutic is nothing but trouble. Certainly from our perspective here at TMS, with the emphasis on the historical, grammatical, literal hermeneutic, we would see nothing good about the allegorical hermeneutic. Here's Needham's discussion of it here in this bottom paragraph. Origen was a controversial figure in his own lifetime and has continued to be so. On the one hand, few Christian leaders from the patristic age can compare with Origen for his noble, humble, gentle character or for his sheer depth and breadth of knowledge, both of Christian theology and pagan philosophy. On the one hand, Origen's own theology gave rise to the most fierce disputes. He claimed that the Bible alone, not Plato or any pagan philosopher, was inspired, and that the Bible must be the basis for all Christian thinking. And I've got some great quotes from Origen that I'll share with you later where he really does affirm sola scriptura. But in fact, Now, in practice, so he says that, but in practice, Platonism greatly shaped and colored Origen's whole outlook. When he interpreted the Bible, he said it had three levels of meaning, which he called the body, literal meaning, the soul, the moral or ethical meaning, and the spirit, the spiritual meaning. Well, isn't that nice? This scheme of interpretation sprang out of Origen's threefold view of human nature as body, soul, and spirit, a view which may itself be rooted in Platonic philosophy. Origen regarded the literal meaning of the Bible as less important than its moral and spiritual meaning. This enabled him to build up his own theology in a way that did not tie it too closely to a literal understanding of the text. So in other words, he could come up with anything he wanted to, because he could make the Bible mean anything he wanted it to mean. Needham gives an example here, and I'll just read the example. The deeper meaning which Origen found in a text is usually called its allegorical meaning. An allegory is a statement or a story in which the words have two levels of meaning. So Litvin kind of set you up for that by starting with C.S. Lewis. And so he's saying, hey, look, the same way you read the Chronicles of Narnia, that's the way you should read Origen. Except C.S. Lewis openly admitted that it was an allegory and didn't take it too seriously. He didn't derive doctrine from it. An allegory is a statement or a story in which the words have two levels of meaning, the obvious meaning and the secret meaning. For example, I could say, three men prepared a meal to feed their children. The obvious meaning is that three male human beings prepared some food to be eaten by their offspring. But I could also say that my statement has a secret allegorical meaning. The three men represent the Trinity. The meal represents the Lord's Supper, and the children represent the church. So the statement, the three men prepared a meal to feed their children, really means the three persons of the Trinity brought the Lord's Supper into being to nourish the church spiritually. And he's getting this example, I think, off of Origen's own writings. Origen tended to interpret the statements and stories of the Bible in this allegorical way. He did not ignore the obvious or literal meaning, but he saw the deeper allegorical meaning as more important. And here's the last paragraph. This way of interpreting the Bible was the method that Greek philosophers used to interpret the traditional stories of the pagan gods in Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. When the obvious literal meaning of a story seemed unworthy of belief, often because it was immoral, philosophers would seek a deeper and more spiritual meaning. Origen was not the first one to do this. Really, the Jews of Alexandria, the Jewish scholars of Alexandria, had started to do this before the time of Christ. Alexandria was a place of higher learning in the ancient Roman world, and the scholarship that was in vogue in that day was this allegorical interpretation. For the pagans, they'd read Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. The gods would do really immoral things, either of a violent or of a sexual nature, perhaps. And, of course, those things shouldn't be imitated. The pagan philosophers even had enough morality to realize that. So they allegorized the story to derive moral lessons from actually immoral accounts in these pagan stories. The Jews in Alexandria started to do that with the Old Testament. Suddenly you could get around some of the difficult passages in the Old Testament by saying, well, maybe this story about all of the enemies of God being slain in a plague or being killed, maybe this really is an allegory that teaches us a deeper spiritual moral lesson about good and evil. The Christians in Alexandria adopted this same perspective, starting all the way back with Barnabas of Alexandria in the Epistle of Barnabas that we talked about earlier in this class. Clement of Alexandria did the same thing. He was the one that really tried to integrate Greek philosophy along with its allegorical interpretation into the church. Origen then followed in his footsteps. So Origen, he's the one that gets blamed for it all because he was the most popular of all of them. But he really inherited this method of interpretation from earlier Christians who inherited it from Jewish scholars who inherited it from Greek scholars in Alexandria, Egypt. It was the popular academic approach of the day. The result, though, is that Origen comes up with some really, really bad doctrines in certain places. Among these bad doctrines is, of course, Origen's teaching of universalism, which recently came to the light again because of Rob Bell's book, Love Wins, where Rob Bell went back and found guys like Origen in church history who taught universalism and used it to justify his own teaching of universalism. Origen even taught that Satan himself would one day be saved. So it's pretty extreme. Like I said, when he's good, he's really good. And when he's bad, he's really bad.
So if we want to just simplify it, historic premillennialism, AD 130 to AD 202, the life of Irenaeus. Okay, but then later you have Origen, which would be AD 185. So that's only about 55 years afterwards to AD 254. He expected, and this is a quote from him, expected that Christianity by continual growth would gain the dominion over the world.
Even if this quote is true, we know that Lukács and a few others have criticisms of his Greek Platonic philosophy and his very liberal interpretation, believing that there would be no literal resurrection of the dead, that it wouldn't be physical, but spiritual. And he was also one of the first church, quote-unquote, fathers to introduce allegory to the scripture. Origen also believed in universalism, that all people will be saved, and he also believed in the pre-existence of souls.
All right, let's continue a little bit further. I've got some more notes here. Two other prominent church fathers whose historical confidence appears to express a postmillennial view would be Athanasius and Augustine. Athanasius, still very early on, a giant in terms of church fathers, 8296 to 8372. That was his life, 8296 to 8372. And Augustine being 8354 to 8430. 8354 to 8430. Consider one statement from Athanasius. The gospel's great progress is expected according to Athanasius' view of Scripture, Isaiah chapter 11, verse 9, Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, John chapter 6, verse 45. Here's the statement from Athanasius. And then from Dan to Beersheba was the law proclaimed, and in Judea only was God known. But now unto all the earth has gone forth their voice, and all the earth has been filled with the knowledge of God, and the disciples have made disciples of all the nations. And now is fulfilled what is written, they shall all be taught of God. That's from Athanasius, Four Discourses Against the Arians. Okay, that's a post-millennial sentiment.
Notice that with Athanasius's quote, he's just paraphrasing Matthew 24:14 and various other scriptures, that the gospel of the kingdom will go to the ends of the earth. And so when Jesus said, go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, yes, the gospel has gone out to the ends of the earth. And so we are at that end of time. We're waiting for that fullness of the Gentiles to come in. So we're at the end of that time. So it wasn't the 800s. It is more like now. Also, you'll note that he said this is a post-mill sentiment. Sentiment. Why did he use the word sentiment instead of a proof? It's not a proof text. It's a sentiment. So a sentiment carries the weight of an attitude towards or an opinion. This is not a post-mill sentiment. It's not a post-mill proof. It is a proof for premillennial post-tribulation eschatology.
Okay, Augustine now, turning to Augustine. Augustine teaches that history, here's a quote, would be marked by the ever-increasing influence of the church in overturning evil in the world before the Lord's return. This would eventually, end of quote, this would eventually issue forth a future rest of the saints on earth. That is a quote from Augustine, Sermon 259:2. Okay? It would eventually, this would eventually, the Great Commission would eventually bring about a future rest of the saints on earth when, continuing the quote now, when the church will be purged of all the wicked elements now mixed among its members and Christ will rule peacefully in its midst. All right, again, that is a post-millennial idea, and that comes from Augustine.
Augustine tells us that the reason, and I think this is supported by the text, but just to bring up a name from church history, Augustine tells us that the reason they spoke in all of these different languages was to underscore the fact that the gospel was to go to all nations on earth. And we really see the fulfillment of the Great Commission in the book of Acts, or at least we see the direction in which church history is going towards that fulfillment, maybe is a better way to say it. In Acts 1 to 7, we see the gospel spread throughout Jerusalem and Judea. In Acts chapter 8, we see the gospel taken to Samaria. And then in Acts chapter 9, starting with the conversion of Saul, and then Acts chapter 10, the conversion of Cornelius, we see the gospel taken then to the ends of the world. So go to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. That commission stands as an outline of the book of Acts. The gospel in Jerusalem and Judea, the gospel in Samaria, and then the gospel going to the uttermost parts of the earth.
We may also reference, continuing, Augustine's comments on Psalm chapter 2 that I referenced earlier regarding the Lord laughing or mocking the nations. Augustine writes this, commentating on Psalm chapter 2, verse 4. It is to be understood of that power which he giveth to his saints, that they seeing things to come, namely, that the name and rule of Christ is to pervade posterity and possess all nations. At verse 7 of Psalm chapter 2, Augustine adds, ask of me may be referred to all this temporal dispensation. That just means time period. All ask of me, the command, that ask of me and I will give the nations to you. Ask of me, may be referred to all this temporal dispensation which has been instituted for mankind, namely, that the nations should be joined to the name of Christ and so be redeemed from death and possessed by God. I shall give thee the nations for thine inheritance, which so possesses them for their salvation and to bear unto thee spiritual fruit. That's Augustine in the Post-Nicene Fathers.
Augustine tells us that the reason they spoke in all of these different languages was to underscore the fact that the gospel was to go to all nations on earth. And we really see the fulfillment of the Great Commission in the book of Acts. Or at least we see the direction in which church history is going towards that fulfillment, maybe is a better way to say it. In Acts 1 to 7, we see the gospel spread throughout Jerusalem and Judea. In Acts chapter 8, we see the gospel taken to Samaria. And then in Acts chapter 9, starting with the conversion of Saul, and then Acts chapter 10, the conversion of Cornelius, we see the gospel taken then to the ends of the world. So go to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. That commission stands as an outline of the book of Acts. The gospel in Jerusalem and Judea, the gospel in Samaria, and then the gospel going to the uttermost parts of the earth.
So Augustine's commentary on the second psalm has nothing to do with post-millennialism. Psalm 2, verses 4 through 12, "He who sits in the heavens shall laugh, the Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king," that's Jesus, "on my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance." That's us. The Gentiles are now the inheritance of Christ. That's a messianic prophecy. So that's this age now, where the gospel, after the stoning of Stephen, went to the Gentiles through Cornelius, and here we are as Gentiles. "And the ends of the earth for your possession." Okay, that's currently being worked out right now, and will be finalized on the day of judgment, right? "You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel." So think of that rock cut without hands in the book of Daniel, being Jesus Christ, the rock that shall shatter the Gentile nations. That's the same prophecy here. "Now therefore be wise, O kings, be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry." So Paul alluding to this in the New Testament. "And you perish in the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those who put their trust in them." So it's a messianic prophecy psalm, and it's talking about the future millennial kingdom, and it's talking about its fulfillment when Jesus will rule in the new heavens and new earth. So nothing to do with post-millennialism here.
All right. In his writings there. We'll continue here in a moment, but the point is this. Irenaeus, being probably the earliest that we see within the witness of church history, very clear, not dispensational, but a classic, a historic pre-mill view. He predates, but only by about 50 years. AD 30 is when he was born. AD 185, so just about 55 years later, we have Origen. And then what we see there is a post-millennial sentiment. And I've already given you some of the quotes from him. And then about 150 years later, and then 200 years later with Athanasius and Augustine, we definitely see a much clearer post-millennial sentiment. And these are two giants within the church fathers still in early church history. So my point is this, for anybody who says that post-millennialism doesn't have any rooting in the church fathers, that it doesn't have really a strong, clear witness within church history, that it's really just a novel idea, something that came about recently, that's simply not true. First, and most importantly, it is biblical. Second, it does have the witness of church history. It is not the earliest eschatology to come onto the scene, but the latest eschatology to come on the scene that doesn't have biblical support and doesn't have the witness of church history is not post-millennialism, but dispensational pre-millennialism.
And then finally, on the issue of premillennialism, here's Eusebius commenting on this man of small mental capacity, as he's already called him in the context. He says this, "The same person, moreover, has set down other things as coming to him from unwritten tradition, Among these, some strange parables and instructions of the Savior, and some other things of a more fabulous nature. Among these, he says that there will be a millennium after the resurrection from the dead, when the personal reign of Christ will be established on the earth. So, there you go. Here's Papias, a hearer of the apostles themselves, a disciple really of the apostle John, a friend of Polycarp who was also a disciple of the apostle John, and Papias clearly teaches that there will be a millennial kingdom after the return of Christ. Irenaeus also records some of Papias's teachings, and he is equally, if not more, explicit in recording Papias's premillennialism. Were there any contemporaries who disagreed with the premillennial position? The answer is not that we have any record of. So every early church leader up until at least the middle of the 3rd century with Clement of Alexandria, that we have an eschatological record of their views, a record of their eschatological views is a better way to say it, they were all premillennialists. There is, in Justin Martyr's account of his own premillennialism, a statement where he says that not everyone is of this same opinion. So there is an amillennialist like to pour their amillennialism into that statement. Justin Martyr doesn't clarify what he means. So it doesn't necessarily mean that the people he's referring to were amillennial, but he does say that there are other people of a different opinion. What that opinion specifically was, he doesn't articulate. The only possible crack in the door for amillennialism is Justin Martyr saying, hey, I'm a premillennialist, but not everyone is of the same opinion in the specifics of how I interpret my eschatology. We'll talk a little bit more about that. I've mentioned Papias and Justin Martyr, but to their names we could add a couple dozen other church fathers who all articulated premillennial views. So we'll spend more time talking about the development of eschatology in this class. I think it's a fascinating study. It really does put the onus on amillennialists to defend their position, because we can demonstrate that those who knew the apostles, the first several generations of church leaders, interpreted apostolic teaching in a premillennial way, universally.
It's yours truly, Pastor Joel Webben.